اه ده هم
ساخين نقول بالشكر يا أبانا الذي في السماوات.
In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, one God. Amen. We thank God for the blessing of this day to have with us one of the most prominent persons in our Coptic Orthodox Church, who is very respected not only by the Coptic people, but wherever I go in any ecumenical gathering, I have sensed how much His Eminence Metropolitan Bishoy is very well respected and revered by the hierarchs and the representatives of other Orthodox and non-Orthodox churches. So it is such a great blessing to have with us tonight His Eminence Metropolitan Bishoy to bless us in this year's theological convention. And you know, God sends us the servants, the good shepherds, the faithful servants, to give us our food in due season. And in a world that is full of heresy and full of deviation from the truth, and individuals are going further away from God to serve their own lusts, we need to see individuals who have kept the true faith strong and alive, strong and alive. And one of those people who continues to be a light in the sky of Orthodoxy is His Eminence Metropolitan Bishoy. I personally learn a lot from His Eminence, from his books. I remember when I was in the monastery, every time His Eminence visits the monastery of Amba Bishoy, I have some questions ready to ask His Eminence. And in fact, today, as soon as he arrived, I had some questions ready to discuss on the way from the airport. And His Eminence is always ready with the answer. He doesn't need to research or look some verses. He has everything memorized in his head. I wish that we can all benefit in the coming 3 days, tonight, all day tomorrow, and also Sunday. I know some of you have come today for the youth meeting, and we joined both groups, those who came for the convention, but also the youth meeting, so that we all can all benefit. But I wish that all of you can come tomorrow as well, and on Sunday, to have the full dosage of the Orthodox vaccination. You know what I mean by the Orthodox vaccination? Because you may encounter people in your schools, in your colleges, at your workplaces that have their own ideas. This world is full of so many heresies. And as you will see, that His Eminence does not talk from his own mind, but he talks from the Bible. So we don't just say any strange concepts, but it's all biblical teaching, because the Orthodox teaching is a biblical teaching. And I can tell you right now that I feel that His Eminence Metropolitan Bishoy, if not the greatest, but at least one of the greatest theologians that are alive. If not the greatest, at least one of the greatest. And I'm sure you will all benefit from His Eminence's knowledge. Please give an attentive ear and also a mind and a heart that will listen to the Word of God, so that you can really and truly benefit from the words that you will hear. We thank His Eminence, and on your behalf, I thank him for coming all the way to be with us. I can't tell you how busy His Eminence is. He is the Metropolitan of Domiat and all its surrounding regions, the Abbot of the nunnery or convent of Saint Demiana, the beautiful convent in Egypt. But he's also the secretary of the Holy Synod of our Coptic Orthodox Church. His Holiness entrusts him with so many things. So to come and spend with us a whole week shows us how much He loves us and we thank him for that. On behalf of all the young people, Your Eminence, we thank you for your love and for your time, for coming all the way to be with us, to bless us, through the intercessions of the Blessed Virgin Mary and through the prayers of our Holy Father, His Holiness Pope Shenouda, and his partner in the apostolic service, His Eminence Metropolitan Bishoy. Glory be to God forever. Amen.
This is a windshield. When you are outdoors, you need this, but you don't need indoor. But we shall keep. Thank you, Your Eminence, Your Grace, for this introduction. I don't deserve all this praise, but it is out of your love and humble person. I am carrying to you the blessings of His Holiness, most beloved Pope Shenouda III. I am thankful to His Grace Bishop David for all the effort he has done to prepare for this conference, for this meeting, and I'm thankful for Father Bishoy Malak Sadek, who is responsible for some preparation from year to year for this conference. Also, I'm thankful for all the priests and people who are serving in this church and all those who are responsible for the meeting, for their effort and love. Thankful for all of you being together with us. I don't know if it is convenient for you to speak in English or not, but I shall do. And you shall be courage enough to hear my broken English. So we have many items in our program. Veneration of icons, saints, clergy, the Holy Cross, and the bread and wine in the Orthodox concept. This is the first lecture, but also we are going to answer your questions. Is this better? Okay. Now, this microphone is going to go to sleep. I am very pleased to be with you these days. And I think the weather is warmer than usual in this time of the year. So I am thankful to the Lord because I am not accustomed for cold weather. You know, Egypt is warmer than here, but some people prefer to be in a cold weather rather than hot one. You know, the scriptures are used by many people in different ways. Some people are using it to defend Christianity, and others are using it to attack Christianity. Also, some people are using it to defend the Orthodox belief, and others are using it to attack the Orthodox belief. I think that our youth, especially in lands of immigration, just say, for example, in North America, are subjected to different ideas, not only that, but even our youth in Middle East are also receiving through internet and satellite television are receiving different ideas in the type of globalization in which you are living today. How to know the truth? Everybody should ask himself how to know the truth. First of all, you should know that even Satan used some verses of the scriptures in the temptation on the mountain when he tried to discuss with the Lord Jesus Christ. He used some verses from the Bible, and the Lord responded to him by other verses. So the controversy was going across the scriptures. It is a good exercise for us also to see that in other topics other than the temptation on the mountain, which contained three types of fight. Fight of body, fight of soul, and fight of spirit, three. Now we are going directly to a very burning issue, because it is written in the second commandment, in the law of Moses, you shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them nor serve them. The first commandment was, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of bondage. You shall have no other gods before me. The second one, you shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. You shall not bow down to them, nor serve them. الوصية الثانية من الوصايا العشر بيقول لا تصنع لك تمثالا منحوتا ولا صورة ما مما في السماء من فوق ولا ما في الأرض من تحت وما في الماء من تحت الأرض. لا تسجد لهن ولا تعبدهن. And now you can see Saint Mary with the Lord Jesus Christ, Saint Mary with Archangel Gabriel, Saint Mark with the famous symbol, the lion, the Lord, Saint John Baptist, and so on. Our church is full of icons, pictures, even inside the altar, in the womb of the Father, the icon of Pantocrator, the Almighty, Jesus sitting on his throne in heaven, surrounded by the five living creatures, the four living creatures, and the 24 priests or ambassadors presenting the prayers of the saints. How can come this commandment is very tightly linked with the first one. You shall have no other gods before me. So this is very clear. You shall not make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above or that in the earth beneath, even in the waters, not only heaven and earth. Now, for a Catholic or an Orthodox person, it is normal to see icons in the church. But we are accused by other denominations that we are worshipping idols, or we are breaking the second commandment. And you know that the Ten Commandments of the Lord can never be broken, forever and ever. So there are accusations everywhere, in councils, in Switzerland, by the Calvinist theologians. There are accusations on the internet. A book written by Dr. George Sabra, We Believe and Confess, Doctrinal Book of the Reformed Churches, on the Lutheran website in the Middle East. There are books published now in Egypt saying that the Orthodox in Egypt are worshipping idols. Wherever we go, we see that we are accused, not only for icons, but also when we venerate and worship the blood, the body and blood of Jesus Christ in the liturgy. The Reformed councils in Switzerland in the 16th century and after decided that this is a pagan worship. So how can you respond to that? If somebody is saying that this is against the Ten Commandments of the Lord. لو واحد قابلك وقال لك انتوا بتكسروا الوصية الثانية من الوصايا العشر واضحة هو الأيقونات هتقول له ايه؟ The first response can be as follows. The commandment is saying, you shall not bow down to them nor serve them. The exact translation of this verse, لا تسجد لهن ولا تعبدهن. You don't worship. Worship. Saying, nor serve them. Serve is not very clear. It is, don't worship. You shall not bow down to them, nor worship them. Very clear. So we don't worship the icons. We worship God. But even the icon of Jesus Christ, we don't worship the icon. If somebody is worshiping the icon, this is a heresy. This is pagan religion. We don't worship. We venerate, but don't worship. نكرم الأيقونات لكن ما نعبدهاش. Now I shall bring something in front of you and tell me how can you justify this in the same book where the Ten Commandments were written for the first time, in the book of Exodus. We were in chapter 20. If we go to chapter 25, what shall we see? God commanded Moses to start building the tabernacle and its constituents. The Lord spoke to Moses, saying, and they shall make an ark of acacia wood. 2.5 cubits shall be its length. And so its width and settings its height. And you shall overlay it with pure gold. Can we photocopy this for tomorrow? This lecture, huh? In English. Inside and out you shall overlay it and shall make on it a molding of gold all around. And you shall put into the ark the testimony which I will give you. That is the 2 stone tablets of the Ten Commandments. You shall make a mercy seat of pure gold. That is the cover of the ark. It is a box, a long box. Two and a half cubits shall be its length, and a cubit and a half its width. 2.5 in this direction, and 1.5 in this direction. Like this table. Its width is smaller than its length. And its height is equal to its width. It's high. So something similar to that, but perhaps bigger. And you shall make 2 cherubim of gold of hammered work you shall make them at the two ends of the mercy seat. Make one cherubim at one end and the other cherub, one cherub at one end and the other cherub at the other end. You shall make the cherubim at the two ends of it of one piece with the mercy seat. And the cherubim shall stretch out their wings above, covering the mercy seat with their wings, and they shall face one another. The faces of the cherubim shall be toward the mercy seat. You shall put the mercy seat on top of the ark, and in the ark you shall put the testimony that I will give you, and there I will meet with you, and I will speak with you from above the mercy seat, from between the two cherubim, which are on the ark of the testimony. About everything which I will give you in commandment to the children of Israel. That is Exodus chapter 25, verses 1, 11, and 16 to 22. Chapter 25. Then in chapter 20, God is saying, make for yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything that is in heaven above, like the cherubim, or that in the earth beneath, or in the water under the earth. And in chapter 25, he's ordering Moses to hammer two golden angels with their wings touching each other and their faces facing each other and looking to the cover of the ark, which is called the mercy seat, where the blood on the day of Kippur, the day of the great atonement, the most important feast other than the Passover, when the atonement is made for all the people of Israel and even for the tabernacle or the temple itself. The blood is put on the mercy seat. Not only that, God was appearing and speaking face to face. That is Jesus Christ, the Son of God, face to face with Moses over the mercy seat between the two cherubim. He said to him, I will speak with you from above the mercy seat, from between the two cherubim, which are on the ark, the testimony of the testimony, about everything which I will give you in commandment to the children of Israel. Later, he told Aaron, the brother of Moses, and Miriam, his sister, I am speaking to Moses face to face. How can you solve this problem? Chapter 20 and chapter 25. As if the commandments are contradicting against each other. And never God is contradicting himself. How come? But how can you solve this problem? In the most holy place, there are two golden angels, and between them, God is appearing and speaking to Moses. And they are put in the Holy of Holies, together with the ark. And anybody entering the temple or the tabernacle is bowing in front of the Holy of Holies, saying, with your mercy, I am entering your house and I am bowing in front of your holy temple in your fear. أما أنا فبكثرة رحمتك أدخل بيتك وأسجد قدام هيكل قدسك بمخافتك. وجوه الاثنين شروبيم جوه قدس الأقداس أي واحد بيسجد والاثنين شروبيم موجودين وتماثيل مش أيقونات. So our situation is less critical than the Catholic Church. They have statues. But even the statues, if they are not worshipped as God, it is not against the teaching of the Holy Scriptures. But we don't have statues in our churches because you know that in Egypt, the religion was very strong with the ancient Egyptians, that our fathers in the early centuries of Christianity were afraid to put statues in the church. So icons were sufficient because they were afraid lest the people would go back to pagan religions, to the pagan religion. So we are using the same way as the Lord Jesus Christ. We are attacked by verses from the book of Exodus, and we are responding with verses from the same book, from chapter 20 to chapter 25. And this would show that if you want to know the truth, you should read the whole Bible and don't be affected by an attack coming from one chapter or one verse. إذا كنتوا هتقفلوا الأبواب اللي ورا يبقى لازم تفتحوا حاجة هنا عشان الأكسجين. أن في ناس ورا عاملين دوشة فممكن نفتح الباب ده شوية كده يجيب لنا شوية أكسجين. Right. Is it possible or not? Possible? Open. Yes. Go on. برد؟ طيب اقفلوا هم فتحوا ورا خلاص. أو شغال التكييف بيجيب هواء يعني ميكسينج اير. Mixing ولا circulating, recirculation ولا يعني في. طب خلاص شغلوا بقى. There are two types of air conditioning. should take care in your house. If it is a split unit, the split unit is only circulating the air to make it cooler and drier, but with no oxygen addition in to substitute the consumption of oxygen by the people inside. So in this way, you should not close all the windows and the doors. Otherwise, you can be suffocated. Because you are pleased with this cold weather, but with no oxygen. But the window type is bringing a ratio of fresh air, mixing and pushing it inside. Or the central air conditioning is doing that also, central. Many people in Egypt are living in an apartment with air conditioning, and they don't open the windows. They are afraid that hot air may come inside, but the oxygen content is going to be consumed and they are going to die. So you should always be careful what type of air conditioning you are using, how many people are in the place, and how long they are going to stay, and so on. For example, you can, if it is circulation only, you can open a window with 5 centimeters only to bring some oxygen. Not here, I mean when it is split type air conditioning. The evaporator is separate from the condenser and the compressor. Now, how can we bring together chapter 20 and chapter 25? The solution that God is warning not to worship any icon or statue as if this is God. But if it is a decoration or a symbol, the ark was a symbol for the throne of God, because the cherubim is covering the throne of God in heaven. So it is a symbol of the throne of God. And God is present when we are in the church. That's why when King Solomon consecrated the temple, when the ark was put inside the Holy of Holies by the priests carrying the ark, the glory of God filled the temple. Even that the priests were afraid and went away quickly from fear, out of fear. And God said that I shall put my eyes on this place And it is called the house of God. So when we worship inside the house of God, we are not worshiping the icon, we are worshiping God filling all the universe, but His presence in His house is active presence. That is to say that in this place, God is hearing us. In this place, God is blessing us. In this place, God is hearing our prayers and giving His grace. This happened earlier than that in the story of Jacob. You know, when Jacob, the great father, was escaping from his brother Esau, he slept in the wilderness. Chapter 28 in the book of Genesis. Verse 10. Now Jacob went out from Beersheba and went toward Haran. So he came to a certain place and stayed there all night because the sun had set. And he took one of the stones of that place and put it at his head. And he lay down in that place to sleep. Then he dreamed, and behold, a ladder was set up on the earth, and its top reached to heaven. And there the angels of God were ascending and descending on it. And behold, the Lord stood above it and said, I am the Lord God of Abraham, your father, and the God of Isaac. The land on which you lie, I will give to you and your descendants. Also your descendants shall be as the dust of the earth. You shall spread abroad to the west and the east, to the north and the south. And in you and in your seed all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Behold, I am with you, and I will keep you wherever you go, and will bring you back to this land. For I will not leave you until I have done what I have spoken to you. Then Jacob awoke from his sleep and said, please give me your attention now. Surely the Lord is in this place, and I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God. And this is the gate of heaven. You know, God is everywhere in the world, in the universe. But why is he said, the Lord is in this place? Because he saw the Lord on the ladder and the angels of the Lord going up and down. And I did not know it. And he was afraid and said, how awesome is this place? That is the church. This is none other than the house of God. And this is the gate of heaven. Then Jacob rose early in the morning and took the stone that he had put at his head, set it up as a pillar, and poured oil on top of it. And he called the name of that place Beth-El, which means the house of God. But the name of that city had been Luz previously. Why he called this place the house of God? God is filling the whole universe. But because God blessed this place, he poured oil on the stone, consecrated it. When he came back after 20 years, he built an altar and he offered sacrifices in the same place. Because he promised God, if you have kept me and brought me back, I shall worship you in this place. He is not worshiping the stone which he consecrated. He's worshiping the God who appeared to him in that place. So God is present in his house by his glory. Although he is present everywhere in the universe, but in this place there is a special blessing. It is the gate of heaven for him. It is the gate of heaven. It is the house of God, but consecrated by a great father, one of the great patriarchs of the Old Testament, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. That's why we consecrate the church. Icons we consecrate. Do you have a mobile telephone, Father? Now, this is a piece of metal, plastic, and wires. Some electronic device. But there is a line, الشريحة اسمها ايه عندكم؟ Chip. Without the chip, it is a beautiful thing, but useless. The icon is a beautiful picture, but there is no ship unless Pop Shenouda is putting holy maroon on it. In this case, it is a line to Saint Mary. A hotline, a harbor of salvation, not salvation of atonement like the body and blood of Jesus Christ, but she is interceding for us in front of her son to give us mercy and to ask to answer our prayers. Pleading intercession, not intercession of atonement, which is done only by the Savior himself. Now, what is an icon in the church? Is it Saint Mary itself? Herself? Of course, no. It is not a living person. Is it just a picture? Also, no. It is a real, blessed harbor where you can contact quickly to the saint of this icon. That's why when you put a candle, because the churches in the ancient time were not lighting like now, the light was very dim, or a slight light was there. So the icon itself, you cannot see who is in the icon. When you put a candle, the icon starts to bright. So the brightness of the icon is coming from the candle. It is a type of honoring this saint because they are the cloud of witnesses surrounding us. They are light because their life is light to the world. You also, according to the words of the Lord, you are the light of the world. So how can the saints and martyrs, how can we say that they are not light for the world? We should look to the end of the story of their lives and make them as an example to us, as St. Paul said. So we don't worship icons. We venerate icons, not worship icons. Now, what about the innocence? The innocence is prayer. They are praying, we are praying. Charity of prayer. In the liturgy, we give innocence to the people. And the priests are giving innocence to each other with the hand of charity. And he is giving innocence to the bishop, but not with the hand of charity, because the bishop is in a priestly order higher than the priest. And also with the people, he is not giving the hand of charity, but is giving innocence like that of the bishop. They say we are worshipping idols when the priest is giving innocence to the bishop. What is this? It is charity of prayer. What the priest is saying? Remember me in your prayers to the other priest and to the bishop. May God preserve the life of our bishop. And at the end of giving the innocence, he's saying, remember me in your prayers. And the bishop is responding to him, saying, may God preserve your priesthood as Aaron and Zechariah and Melchizedek. So it is charity of prayer between the priests, between the priest and the bishop, between the bishop and the bishop, between the priest and the people. All are praying. The innocence is going up to show that the whole church is praying. What happened in the beginning of the New Testament? The very beginning, that Zechariah, the priest, the father of John Baptist, was raising innocence in the temple, and the people outside were praying. At the very beginning of the events of the New Testament, at that moment, Saint Gabriel appeared to him at the right-hand side of the altar of innocence and started to speak to him that you will have a child and call him John. He will prepare the way for the Savior Jesus Christ. The people were praying and he was raising innocence. Why at the same time? That is the charity of prayer. مرة أيام البابا كيرلس السادس الله ينيح نفسه، كان المطران الأنبا متاؤس في الزقازيق كلف أبونا جبرائيل السورياني يسلم القداس لأسيس جديد هو رسمه المطران. أما متاؤس كان مطران الزقازيق والشرقية والقنال بورسعيد والإسماعيلية والسويس. وكان أبونا جبرائيل السورياني بيخدم عنده، فكان يحب الضحك، فقال للأسيس الجديد هو بيسلمه القداس، قال لما تبخر للمطران تقول عبادة الأصنام بالكمال إخلاعها من العالم، الشيطان وكل قواته الشريرة اسحقهم وأذلهم تحت أقدامنا سريعا. فالأسيس الجديد مش عارف، هو المفروض يقول حفظا الرب يحفظ حياة أبينا المطران الأنبا فلان، حفظا احفظه لنا سنين كثيرة وأزمنة سالمة. فبعد ما استلم، ما بيقعد 40 يوم يستلم، بعد ما استلم وجه يصلي في الكنيسة القداس في حضور نيافة المطران، فبيبخر قال عبادة الأصنام بالكمال إخلاع من العالم. فقال له إيه أنا وثن، أنا وثن بتقول إيه؟ قال له أنا أخطيت في إيه؟ قال له بتقول إيه اللي قال لك تقول كده؟ قال له أبونا جبرائيل سلمني كده. فراح اشتكى لقداسة البابا كيرلس السادس المطران، قال له أبونا جبرائيل يقول له يقول عبادة الأوثان بكمال إخلاعها من العالم. فراح إيه حكم على أبونا جبرائيل يقعد 6 أشهر في دير السوريان ما يصليش، ياخد عقوبة على الهزار اللي عمله ده. في الوقت ده أنا رحت أتراه من في دير السوريان، فليت أبونا جبرائيل هناك، ما انا ما اعرفش ان هو متأنن يعني، وانا لسه جديد. ليها قصص تانية مش وقتها دلوقتي، بس المهم اللي عايز اقوله انه فعلا ساعات في ناس بتفهم الكلام ده غلط. هو عملها هزار يعني، ابونا كان يحب الضحك. ده أبونا بنيامين من هناك من الزقازيق عارف القصة. قال له إيه؟ قال له علي صوتك عشان سيدنا المطران يتبسط منك. قصة مشهورة يعني. عبادة الأوثان بالكمال أخلاقنا. هو بيقول الرب يحفظ لنا حياة وقيام أمين المطران الأنبا فلان حفظا احفظه لنا سنين كثيرة، أسألك يا أبي المطران أن تذكرني في صلاتك. فهو يقول الرب يحفظ كهنوتك، بيمسك الصليب ويرشمه كده مثل ملك صادق وهيون وهارون وزكريا كهنة الله العلي. ولو بيبخر لكاهن زميله بيقول له أسألك يا أبي القس أو يا أبي القمص أن تذكرني في صلاتك لكي المسيح إله يغفر لي خطايا كثيرة. يقول له برضو الرب يحفظ كهنوتك ويعمل على أيديك كده مثل ملك صادق وهارون وزكريا كهنة الله العلي. شركة الصلاة، charity of prayer. That's all. But it is falsified. Falsified. We are accused that we worship idols in the church. We don't worship icons. We don't consider that this is Jesus Christ. It is only an icon of Jesus Christ, but it is not the Lord. We don't worship this icon. When we bow here, we bow to the glory of God present in his house. We worship God who is filling by his divinity the whole universe. We worship the incarnate Word of God, who is Jesus Christ. He is sitting on the right hand of the Father in the highest. But if Christ himself is present in the church, we worship him like the born blind person. When he opened, he created new eyes for him. He asked him, "Do you believe in the Son of God?" And when he knew that Jesus is the Son of God, he worshipped him. He bowed in front of him. He said, "I believe my Lord." And he worshipped him. If Jesus Christ personally is here, we can worship him, but not his icon. We don't worship the icon. But the icon is venerated when it is consecrated by Holy Mairun, because it is a way of communication with heaven, or it is bringing to us a dear memory that the Lord is the teacher, is the king. The Lord was baptized. The Lord is crucified. But what about the cross? The cross. There is a difference between this cross and this cross and the real cross on which the blood of Jesus Christ was absorbed on the day of his crucifixion. The original cross is something, and this cross is another thing. We bless with the cross, bless the people. It is the mark of victory over Satan. But the original cross is another thing. In this original cross is the blood, the divine blood of the Lord. Who was nailed on this wood. So many songs which we say concerning the cross started with the discovered real original cross of the Lord. Many songs are directed to the real cross. I mean the original. But this does not mean that we cannot venerate any other cross, especially if it is consecrated with Holy Mairun. This veneration does not mean that we worship this cross. It is not God. How can we worship a piece of wood? This is completely refused. This wood in the church, even consecrated with Holy Mairun, we don't worship the wood. We worship God, not the wood. Even the marble altar, we bow in front of the altar exactly as the people of Israel were doing in front of the ark, made of wood and gold. Because it is the seat of mercy. Here is the seat of mercy, where the blood and body of Jesus Christ are present in the liturgy. We worship the body and blood of Jesus Christ. Because it is his commandment. This is my body, this is my blood. But we don't worship the altar itself. It is only venerated. The marble. After consecration, we bow here, but not to the marble, not to the stone, but to the glory of God, who is filling this place, because this is the house of God and this is the gate of heaven. To God present in the place. And if during the Mass we worship the body and blood of Jesus Christ, on the top of the altar, not the marble, not the stone. This is the exceptional thing. The body and blood of Jesus, we worship. That is a reality. Because it is the true body and true blood of Jesus Christ. The Protestants are saying, we are making the bread, we are making our God, and we are worshipping it. العجين بيسموه إيه لما حد يعجن؟ ها؟ D D O U G H. They say they are doing their God and baking him and worshipping what they have baked and dough. What can you say? We are manufacturing our God and worshipping him. What can you say? A small question to this Protestant you can ask. What about the bread which Jesus ate baked by Saint Mary? Through the years of his life, he was growing, as a child growing. And when he was crucified, he was not 1 gram as the beginning of incarnation, or a part of a gram or a milligram, but he is now 70 kilogram, I mean. Where the bread went, which he ate? It was building his body. And he was growing. Now, is incarnation repeated every meal, or it is extension of incarnation? It is repeated with every gram or kilogram added to his weight, incarnation, or it happened once and forever. So the bread came into his body, united to his divinity, and became his own body. That is the sacrament of Eucharist. It is the action of the Holy Spirit that the same destiny of the bread baked by Saint Mary and added to the body of the Lord, crucified, risen from the dead, ascended to heaven, is the same that happens to the bread in the Mass, in the Holy Mass. It is the body of Jesus Christ after the coming of the Holy Spirit. So it is a great mystery, but instituted by the Lord himself. What is our mistake? What is our guilt? Are we guilty because we obey his commandment? Do this in remembrance of me. That's why it is a great crime to eat without repentance. من يأكل ويشرب بدون استحقاق يكون مجرما في جسد الرب. Whosoever is eating and drinking while he is not deserving, he is committing a crime against the body of Christ, of the Lord. Why it is a crime? Because it is a real body and real blood. All over the world, all the churches celebrated the Eucharist. In Egypt, in Ethiopia, in India, in Europe, in Rome, in Constantinople, and at last in Germany came Martin Luther. And more Protestant, Calvin and Zwingli, opposing the Eucharist. But how can we accept something which is against the whole tradition of the universal church? It is not a mistake of the Church of Rome. It is a universal tradition. And the writings of the Holy Fathers are insisting that without this holy sacrament, nobody can inherit eternal life. That's why we say we should defend the Orthodox belief. Veneration of icons, veneration of saints, veneration of the clergy, veneration of the cross, and worshipping the body and blood of Jesus Christ. We are not pagan. We are true Christians. You know, this lecture in front of me is 30 pages in English. We shall photocopy it for you, for the members of the conference. Perhaps tomorrow you can have it. You can read in detail. But those who are not going to attend with us other days can have a copy through their priest or any friend. We need some minutes on the screen. Can we take a look? I think we can continue in another meeting. The only thing I want to tell you about this PowerPoint, that it was made in Egypt. So, but it will be put on the internet, because as Da Vinci Code has caused many people to doubt about Christianity, also the Book of Azazel is a great temptation for many people in Egypt, but they are going to spread it all over the world. So before it would start to reach the people everywhere in the world, we are preparing the response. So it is something similar to Da Vinci Code, with many concepts shared between them. So later we can speak more about this thing, but I think it is sufficient today. Yes, Dr. Dawood.
If there is any difference in the translation, yes, we can blame them for that. But I've read both books, and I found the translation could not be that exact but is not far away.
Which book?
For Tess Azazel.
It is not Tess. It is called only Azazel.
Azazel, I know. But yani, the meaning is, we know the Jewish tradition has Tess Azazel.
Yes, it is.
The two of them
Azazel,
similar. And
Azazel is
away.
A Hebrew word. Az means good. G-O-A-T. And Azil means separation in a far place. So as Azil means the good which carries the sins far away. But it is not a name of Satan. Baal Zabub, Baal Zabul is one of the names of Satan in the Jewish tradition, but not Azazel.
Not Azazel. I saw your answers, Your Eminence answers, and they were great. But are you directing them to the Muslim translator or to the writer who originally wrote that before the translation to Arabic?
The translation is not published yet. We started to respond before he would publish the translation. They say, we shall put this on the internet.
Before that comes?
Yeah.
That's great.
Thank you.
Thank you. That's great. One more thing is,
yeah.
Your Eminence mentioned something about the Protestant and the Incarnate. They even go far beyond that. They claim that الذبيحة بتاعتنا ذبيحة مكررة وإحنا بنقتل المسيح كل شوية
repetition.
بينما هي ذبيحة واحدة حصلت على الصليب وخلاص يعني ريتني أفتك تشرح لنا الحاجات دي
عشان. The question about Eucharist, is it a repetition of crucifixion of the Lord? No, it is extension, because the sacrifice of the cross can be present over time. Omnipresent. So it is not a normal sacrifice like a lamb, an animal, but it is a divine sacrifice. That's why it is possible that it can be present till the end of time. Till the second coming of Christ. He said, do this in remembrance of me. And St. Paul said, whenever we eat and drink the Eucharist, we are commemorating the death of our Lord. Why commemorating? Because his sacrifice is present, the crucified body, the rising body, the ascended body, because when he was rising from the dead, the wounds of the cross were still there. So we can see the cross in the risen Lord, and we can see resurrection in the crucified Lord, because he was hanged on the cross, and he was standing up. So he is giving us the impression that he is going to rise from the dead. So it is not a repetition. It is the same sacrifice of the cross. We can speak more tomorrow about the Eucharist and its concept in the Orthodox Church. But we should close now our meeting, otherwise nobody will reach his home. Thank you very much. Let us pray.
We thank His Eminence for this wonderful words and presentation, so that we can now begin to understand how to respond to those who accuse us of worshiping icons. We don't worship icons, we venerate icons. or we don't worship the saints, we ask for their prayers, the sign of the cross, but we worship the body and the blood of the Lord, who said to us that this is my body and my blood? Through his words, this the bread becomes the body and the blood of the Lord, and that's why we worship them. So thank His Eminence for this important clarification. Tomorrow we have the liturgy tomorrow morning. Hopefully the liturgy can end at 10 o'clock so that you have 1 hour to have breakfast. And then we begin our second lecture at 11. Okay? بتدرس الساعة كم بقول؟ ها؟ 8 to 10 يعني رتم قلت 10:30 بس ايه؟ لو قدرنا نسرع رتم سنة يعني. So we have the first lecture from 11 to 1 and then we have half an hour break and then we take another lecture. And then the final lecture tomorrow. المحاضرة الأخيرة الساعة كم بكرة أبونا؟ From 7 after Vespers. So tomorrow we have 3 lectures and on Sunday we have 1 lecture after the liturgy. God willing. Okay? So this is the program for tomorrow. We want to see all of you tomorrow, God willing, inshallah. So go and have a good night's sleep and come tomorrow to learn more about our faith. Thank you. We can ask. Oh, سيدنا قالها تتحط على
الانترنت. I have some copies. This copy for Father Kirillos, and he is ready to copy it for any. He can post also. He will use every type of technology. One person is asking, was Emperor Constantine baptized Arian? If so, how is he considered a saint? He was baptized at the end of his life by a semi-Arian bishop. There were 2 semi-Arian bishops, Eusebius the Nicomedian and Eusebius the Caesarian of Caesarea. And he was baptized on the bed of his death but by a semi-Arian bishop. But because he defended the divinity of Christ by affirming the Christian creed at the Nicene Council, not he decided, he confirmed only what the council produced. So the church considered him as the first emperor who gave freedom to the Christians and also the emperor who caused the church to preserve the apostolic faith in the divinity of Christ. He persecuted Saint Athanasius by the interference of the Cappadocian people like Eusebius the Nicomedian and Eusebius of Caesarea and caused some troubles for our Coptic church. Now, in Constantinople, he is venerated and we accepted it historically, but we discussed this in our Holy Synod and we are not very favorite to consider him as a saint. But we don't want to make a universal explosion now. Because you know, the Greek Orthodox would insist that he is a saint. And we are trying to bring together the 2 families of Orthodoxy. So when we discuss this in the Holy Synod, we agreed together to postpone taking a decision about Constantine. Huh? just not to bring a new cause of division among the churches. But in my inner feeling, I respect his positive doings, but I cannot consider him as a saint. I respect him as an emperor, but not as a saint. His mother built San Damiana Monastery and the Resurrection Church in Jerusalem. His mother is a saint, was fully Christian all over the time. But for him, he is venerated as an emperor who helped Christianity, who declared the document of religious freedom in Milan, 313. So I venerate him as an emperor, but not as a saint. But we don't want now to make an official declaration to the whole world about this topic, because we don't want to create a new cause of division among the churches. So if in your inner feeling you don't believe he is a saint, it is okay. You can consider him as a hero of history, but not a hero of saintly life, as a true saint in Christianity. Okay? Let us pray. تمام يا رب جعلنا مستحقين نقول بالشكر يا أبانا الذي في السماوات.